Andrew is an expert in all things, apparently. It's funny, when I asked him, I was like, I did exactly what you told me not to do. I'm so bad at direction. I'm playing with glasses. I'm drunk, I don't know, so excuses. Andrew does everything. I asked him how to introduce himself, or how I would introduce him, and he was like, I don't know, just say really do things, which made it sound like a hobo came in off the street. But for real, Andrew speaks all over town. He's amazing. I accosted him after I heard him speak, and he was kind enough to come here and talk to you guys. He also teaches a class in fun at an academic level at the University of Colorado Denver. So, if that is not... Yeah, this guy, right? If that's not enough of an expertise, I don't know what is. So, with no further ado, Andrew.
Stuff out of the way, we're gonna get really serious and talk about. Does everyone know what GPS is, first of all?
Yeah.
It's global positioning system. It's what's in your phone, it's what's in your it's in a lot of things that help you see where you are. It's in your car. So global positioning system, it's a bunch of satellites. And so I want to talk about how it works, because in talking with people, everyone's like, oh, my GPS is broken or whatever. Like, no one knows really how it works as far as that I've come across. But in order to explain it, I want to invoke Flav of Flav. Alright, so Flav is going to help explain GPS. Right. You can pump up that audio because I'm not going to be talking during it. So what is GPS? It's a positioning and navigation service with up to 32 satellites. There's actually even more satellites, but there's 32. There's slots in the data for 32 satellites. And so, oops, that was not the right button. Where's my pointer? Oh yeah, there we go. So these satellites are precessing around the globe in six different orbital planes, and so they really are covering 99.9% of the globe. So anywhere on Earth, and that's one of the reasons why GPS is so great, is because you could get it from anywhere on Earth. There's semi-synchronous orbits. Does anybody know what that is? Sort of synchronous, yes. It's like semi-sweet chocolate chips, but or orbiting. Now, semi in this case means half. They're actually at half a geosynchronous orbit. So like a satellite that, say like your DirecTV or something like that, where you put a dish on the side of your house and you just point it once and it always gets the satellite, that satellite is called geosynchronous orbit. So it's always in the same place in the sky. So as the Earth goes around, it's always the same. So a semi-synchronous orbit is actually, it's half the altitude of a synchronous orbit. So it actually goes around the globe twice per day. So any particular satellite will actually pass overhead twice. And they're actually moving fairly fast because they go around the Earth twice in a day. So in this 20,000 kilometers.
Yo, we got to get stupid, yo!
All right, let's get stupid with some satellite nerd talk here. So, the first GPS satellite was launched in 1978, and it's a Department of Defense system. So U.S. DOD, super scary military stuff. And they basically just want to use it for positioning. It's not for spying. A lot of people think, like, oh, I'm not going to put my GPS on because I don't want the government to know where I am. But it's actually a one-way system. So these satellites are sending data in kind of a wide band direction towards Earth. So when you're receiving the data, you're not actually sending any data anywhere. So unless you have some app on your phone that someone who wants to stalk you put on your phone without you knowing, and it sends out the information about GPS. But The US government doesn't know where you are based on GPS. But when they put a few satellites up in the air, but it really doesn't do that much good if you only have a few satellites. You need to have a lot of satellites, and so you get information from a lot of satellites at the same time, and that's how you get your positioning. So they started building this constellation, and these things cost billions and billions of dollars, so and it takes years to make them. But a lot of them were made in Colorado, right here in South Denver at Lockheed Martin. The whole Block 2 and 2R satellites during that time range. And so what they do, they basically broadcast data. That's just what they do. They broadcast data at 1500 megahertz. There's two frequencies, actually, this L1 and L2. I think I might talk about that a little. But it's encrypted data with two different kinds of codes of it. And so there's a CA code and a P code. And so the CA code is something that is used for civilian use. So if it's in your phone, it's CA code. You need military clearance to run a P code receiver. What happened in the 90s, so it had full operational capability. So in the 90s, they started building it into things. You know, it's in a car, you can have a handheld, and then, you know, more recently, cell phones and things. And so it's now, it really is, you know, the government is running a civilian service now. So how does it work? Flav is gonna help. So these satellites basically broadcast their position. Every second, they send out a big chunk of data at a fairly high data rate. And they're sending out a bunch of information. One is their position. There's a lot of things about their, which orbital plane they're on, what part of the troposphere they are around, their speed, because they're moving pretty fast. And so the users receive the messages from the satellite.
Yo, we got to do something about that, man. Yo, we got to be stupid. Yo, we got to know what time it is.
We got to know what time it is, which is the crux of how GPS satellites work. You get all this information from all these satellites that you can see overhead, and they all have atomic clocks on board. And they're all synchronized to each other within probably 20 nanoseconds, so 20 billionths of a second. And so they're broadcasting where they are, and they're broadcasting at the same time. But being here on Earth, you're actually gonna get a signal sooner from one that's directly overhead than one that's on the horizon, because it has to go a lot further. So every second, you get information from, you know, 5 to up to 12 satellites. And you get it, even though they send it at the same time, you actually get the data at slightly different times from each other. And so you gather all that data, and with microprocessor, you start to figure out where you are on the globe. So it all has to do with atomic clocks. I've done some other talks about. Has anyone seen any talks I've done about atomic clocks? Woo! Yeah, I've. if you ask me something about it, I may never stop talking. So just be careful what you wish for. I should say, maybe I'll intro myself a little. I actually work at the National Institute of Standards and Technology, measuring atomic clocks. So that's my day job. So that's the official government standards lab, and I'm in the time and frequency department. So we're measuring atomic clocks remotely. We use GPS every day, comparing atomic clocks or comparing ground-based clocks using GPS as a transfer mechanism. So it's very cool. So when a satellite or when anything, a radio station, a walkie-talkie, something that sends out a frequency, it travels at roughly the speed of light. And it does have to go through like the ionosphere, the troposphere, gets noisy, can change the speed. But we can say that that a radio frequency signal basically travels at the speed of light. And so a 1 meter is equivalent to 3.3 nanoseconds. We always say like a nanosecond a foot. It's a rough estimate, but so you can see where you really need to be able to distinguish nanoseconds in order to get close even to like a meter of positioning. I got super nerdy here when I said 1 part in 10 to the 13th stability. That's like clock talk. But there's all sorts of different equations that come in with comparing clocks, and we talk about stability, and there's this whole new set of math talking about something, because all clocks are changing in frequency all the time. I don't know if you knew that, but so this is just, let's just say this is really good, like 13 decimal places of stability. Oh, whoops, I meant to start that earlier while I was talking, so you could be like mesmerized by the atomic clock. So let's talk about some equations here, pseudo-range calculation. In almost every talk that I do, I feel like I throw an equation up there because it's just, everyone gets nervous and they're like, oh, okay, I'm gonna get a drink, this sucks. I don't wanna learn anything, I just wanna like see something. So I'm not really gonna talk too much about this, but C is the speed of light, that's something. This is the ionosphere, the troposphere, but basically you have to, when you get the signal from all these different satellites, you have to reiterate it through for each satellite and multiple times and go through this equation to get the pseudo range, which in the end tells you where you are, you know, latitude, longitude, and altitude. So these are all the monitoring stations for the satellites. And these are all US government, government posse. And as the satellites go overhead, all these stations are measuring compared to ground-based clocks. And they're actually comparing all of the satellite clocks to each other. There's a really big benefit if you actually already have your position. So if you have like a set position, like you're not moving, then when you gather information from the satellites and it's giving you this pseudo-range information, since you know where you are, you can actually hone in on what's happening with the clocks on the satellites. We can actually measure the satellite clocks on a ground-based station because we're not moving. And we know the right answer of like, what our position is. So as the satellites go overhead, these ground stations are measuring and adding corrections to the satellites. And they're moving fairly quickly, and if you know anything about relativity, you will know that frequency and relativity, frequency and motion are tied together with time dilation. So there actually is a pretty high relativistic effect of the clocks on board the satellites. You need to correct that all out. The main control station is actually at Schreiber Air Force Base in Colorado Springs. So Colorado actually has a pretty big part of GPS in several ways. All the clocks are run by the USNO. It's the US Naval Observatory in Washington, DC. So spread spectrum communication. Also, I'm not gonna explain. So spread spectrum is a way of communication where instead of having like a signal at like a particular frequency range, the data is actually spread across a wide range. And it can it actually helps with spoofing and jamming and things. But it's also, the signal is really far down in the noise. So you really are fighting the power. I mean, these things are 20,000 kilometers away sending you a radio frequency. And in this world of all these frequencies flying around, it's kind of hard to get the satellites. And that's another thing I'll point out, Mythbuster here. So when you see on TV and there's like, they're following, like on CSI or Law and Order or something, they're following somebody, inside of a house or a parking garage, like, first of all, I don't know how they know where that person is, because even if that person had like a GPS, they're not telling the cops where they are. But also, you have to have a sky view, so you have to actually be basically outside. You could put a GPS antenna in a window, but you're only gonna see the satellites that are on that side. It would be pretty hard to find too good of a position even through a window. So, and it, cause it's very low power. A radio station, like a local, you know, KBPI type radio station, is a very high power and it's very localized. That's why you can get it through walls and windows and things. So you really can't get GPS inside at this point. But it's also because of how they're trying to really hide the signal and the noise. So that it was by design. Because really, you know, like, we want to use it, but we don't want other bad guys to use it. So that's, I mean, it's a military system. So selective availability. So when the military, when they started using this, they, you know, they want to have, they realize that other people can get it, right? But they actually put noise on the signal to make it worse for civilian use. So that's called selective availability, where they could actually turn up the noise. You know? So that's pretty cool. You know where this is coming. With selective availability off, and you can actually see your range is really within probably a 50 nanosecond band there. So you know your positioning can be good, but when you have selective availability on, it's actually much worse, and you have to have a P-code receiver in order to take this, what looks like random noise, is actually encrypted. But since it really became such a high use for civilians, I think an Al Gore was actually part of this, but they actually got them to turn selective availability off. So it was in year 2000, I think March or April in year 2000, they turned selective availability off to actually make it better for positioning for civilian use.